up sick this past Wednesday morning. I had a sore throat, body aches, and a headache. Now, I always wake up with body aches and a headache. It was the sore throat that clued me in that I was sick. Now, historically, for the 20 years that I've been a teacher, my first thought upon waking up sick has always been, uh-oh, I can't call out of work today. Well, Wednesday was a little different because that was my second thought. My first thought was, oh my God, what if I have the coronavirus? Hi, I'm Linda. This is Linda's World, and this is Self-Care Sundays. And tonight, we're talking about maintaining our mental health during the coronavirus pandemic. You see, there's been a lot of coverage in the media in the past couple of weeks about what to do about the situation. Physically, how to wash your hands, what to buy in the event of an emergency, what schools have been closed, what cities have been affected, how many people have been infected, how many people have recovered, how many people haven't, and so on and so on. But precious little, to the best of my knowledge, has been said about what it's doing to the individuals in society in here and in here to see such a situation go on. What are the psychological ramifications of walking around in a world where people are washing their hands obsessively and wearing masks and freaking out that we're all gonna die? Where do you put that in your head? Where do you put that in your heart? What do you do to maintain a sense of calm and not run screaming through the streets? Well, I have some tips for you about those things, and those tips begin right now. I'd like to begin tonight with a little bit of a confession, if I may. You see, a couple of weeks ago, I heard the term coronavirus for the first time, and I knew literally nothing about it, so I had a great deal of fun laughing about memes online and making jokes. You know, corona beer, coronavirus, things like that. Well, I'm eating my words, because in the couple of weeks since, the situation has gotten really intense. We're using the word pandemic officially to describe the situation. Donald Trump has declared a state of emergency in the US, and other countries are also suffering. Now, this evening, you may hear me saying in our country or in the US an awful lot, and I don't mean to deflect attention from people who are suffering abroad. It's just that according to my analytics on YouTube, most of my viewers are here in US soil, and so, you know me, I like to talk to you guys personally. I feel like you're all sitting in my living room with me and listening to me give you sound advice or tell you a story or list things that I think are important to us or whatever it is, because I feel like I'm talking directly to you. Now, as we're on the subject of my viewers, I'd like to say that if you're just finding this video by happenstance and you aren't yet a member of Linda's World, why don't you go ahead and hit that subscribe button down below and hit the notification bell as well so you can tell when all new videos drop to my channel. Linda's World is largely an inspirational channel, a place where you can come to escape the real world for just a little while and return back to it later with the tools you need to live your best life, even when you're not exactly living your best life. And now, if I may, I'd like to tell you a little bit about how I've been maintaining a sense of decent mental health and calm during this coronavirus pandemic. I think that before we get into how to handle the situation emotionally, it's really important to define our terms as what the situation actually is. Layman's terms so we can all understand so that we could breathe a little easier. No pun intended, okay? Now, coronavirus is the popular name that we've given in the media to COVID-19, which is a new strain of coronaviruses, the viruses that transmit respiratory infection, okay, and lead to respiratory illnesses. Symptoms usually include a fever, a cough, and shortness of breath. If left untreated, that cough and shortness of breath leads to pneumonia, and there are your complications. People who are infected with the virus become symptomatic within two days to a week after initial contact. And it is important to note that even if you are asymptomatic of the virus, you can transmit it from one guy to another guy. So if you met Bob on Sunday and he had it, and then you saw Tom on Monday, you can give Tom Bob's virus and feel nothing for your own self. Just saying, okay? Now, people who are adults who maintain a general sense of good health kind of have nothing to fear, okay? For example, I'm 43 and I do not have a compromised immune system. Thank heavens. I have pre-existing conditions, but they're mostly injury, not illness. They're sort of exoskeletal, so we'll leave it at that. Now, there are risk groups, okay? The very young, preschool-age children, the elderly, they determine as people over 60, although quite frankly, I don't know that 60 is elderly, but That's me. I'm not a scientist. People with compromised immune systems, people who are fighting various illnesses, asthma, diabetes, cancer, congestive heart failure, people who are prone to bronchitis and pneumonia. Okay, smokers, as a matter of fact, which is something I just picked up yesterday from an article on Twitter. So these are the people who need to watch the heck out. Okay, now, remember what I said about being a carrier. So if you are an adult who maintains a general sense of good health, but your mom, who is 86 and lying in the bed with various conditions, is not, well, you can take it from Bob, okay, and bring it home to mom. So that's something you need to be made aware of. Okay, now that we've gone through the physical manifestations of the disease, I would like to tell you a couple of statistics, and then we're going to get into what it is emotionally that we can do to handle this situation so that we don't run screaming down the street saying we're all going to die, we're all going to die. Because folks, we're not. Okay? Trust me. We're not. So my research was done last night, which was Friday the 13th. Sorry about that, at about 8 o'clock last night. And the internet research I did told me that on US soil to date, there have been 2,836 cases of coronavirus on US soil. Of those cases, 106 have been closed, with 57 people dying and 49 people making a full recovery. Those are your odds. Those are your statistics. So there it is. Now, there have reason to believe that the virus originated in China, and due to various means of travel, people in Italy have been greatly affected. I understand that South Korea has been affected as well, and if I'm skipping anybody, I sincerely apologize. I research what I can. Okay, so what do we do with all this? Well, I'd like to give you my take. So it was a couple of weeks ago that I started walking around my neighborhood and seeing people with those gosh darn surgical masks on. Now, in my whole life, I mean, I've pretty much only seen surgical masks on, like, you know, medical professionals and also the ladies who do my nails. Very often, nail technicians will put the masks on because of the fumes of the acetone and what have you that they use to build acrylic nails, which I am getting very soon again, but that's a whole other video. So now, then all of a sudden I start seeing people with the mask on their face and I'm like, what the heck is going on, right? And then I, you know, looked things up and figured things out and I said, oh my God, okay, we've got a virus, you know, whatever. And I started, like, you know, doing my homework, you know? And so I gotta tell you, and here's where the emotional component comes in, and I'm so sorry it's coming later on in this video than I wanted it to, but the emotional component of this is that it's grating as hell. It takes a toll on one's psyche to be walking around your city with seeing people putting on the freaking surgical masks, because it brings to mind things we've known in history, you know, like Chernobyl, for you know, an example, or like Hiroshima and Nagasaki, you know, places that have been hit with atomic weapons or chemical warfare or something, and people walking around trying to, like, stave off, like, asphyxiation, you know, or, like, give chromosome damage to their offspring and stuff like that from breathing the fumes. Like, that's what it reminds me of. You know, I've seen the movies. I've seen the footage of, like, post-World War II Europe and, you know, like, you know, I grew up a U.S. history student myself, and it's just, it's mind-boggling. It's scary as shit, okay? And it takes a toll on one's emotions without you even realizing it. You know, like, if you walk around, you know, each day and, like, you know, life is a grind and this and that, like, you have your own problems and people are stuck in their own worlds with their little phones and having their own little problems, right? And I'm no stranger to that, of course. You know, my whole channel is kind of built on that, right? And then you start seeing societal problems and you go, wait a second, I've got enough shit to deal with. Why do I have to look at this? But the guy with the mask on, you know what he's thinking? He's thinking, I got enough shit to deal with. I can't get sick right now. Okay? So in other words, everyone has come up with their own bizarre coping mechanisms to handle the situation. Now, here's a ridiculous analogy. Okay? So my mother taught me this. Now, she didn't tell it to me. It's just that I observed her and I learned. Okay? She taught me two things. One is that she would buy in bulk. She would have extra ketchups and mayos. She would have a closet full of toilet paper and paper towels. She would have boxes of cake mix just in case of a birthday. She had like non-perishables stacked up as far as the eye could see. And what I gleaned from that message was that my mother was always prepared, that she believed that in the event that all hell broke loose, at least she had the groceries, right? And so, you know, well, that's why when I see these people like hysterical and fighting each other at Costco for toilet paper, I'm just like, no, that's not the way it's done. It doesn't take a pandemic for you to all of a sudden go ahead and decide to organize your life. You know, like the Doomsday Prepper show that my ex-husband used to make me watch used to make me cry, because I'm like, why are these people taking it to such an extreme? And I'd get mad at these people. I'm like, this one dude had built an ecosystem in his underground pool, and if he an inventive an emergency was gonna live in it and grow plants, and you know. And I was like, bro, what's wrong with you? And then it all came out. I thought to myself, this person is doing what they can to control their environment. And after all, that's what we're all trying to do here. Our environment is in turmoil. We don't know what the future holds for our environment. And so as best as we can, buying toilet paper, wearing a mask, whatever the hell it is, we're controlling our environment. We know we can't control what happens in nature, okay? The little man in our heads knows this, but we don't want to know that. And so therefore we fight it as best we can by stockpiling our supplies. Okay, you know, I'm thinking of Vic DiPetetto and, you know, gotta get the bread and milk. You know, have you seen that guy? You know,
I gotta get the bread and milk. I gotta get the bread and milk. Oh my God, I gotta get the bread and milk. I gotta get the bread and milk. I gotta get the bread and milk. They said snow. I gotta get the bread and milk.
You know, like, he's making fun of it, but there's some merit in that. You know, if you have the supplies in the house, you don't have to worry later. And so that's something I learned. And another thing I learned is putting humor into a situation. Now, I apologized earlier in this video about laughing at those memes, you know, but the thing is, they're helpful, you know. Just recently, I posted one today, mocking the toilet paper people. It was a dog. He was a golden retriever, I believe. And he was scooting his butt along the rug, right? And the meme said, sorry, mom, no toilet paper. And I thought that was hilarious, okay? So it's because that person who made that meme and this person who shared the meme was finding light in a dark time. And that is my principal advice for you this evening. Find light in this dark time. Make the most of the situation. Take, you know, lemons and turn to lemonade, you know, and all that stuff. And I know those things sound trite, but they're easier done than you think. Like, for example, let's say that you are afraid to go outside or can't because you're quarantined, okay? Self-quarantined, of course, because they haven't issued a curfew or anything like that, right? Then what you do is you say, all right, I'm gonna clean the hell out of my house. Time to do spring cleaning and do the closets. Right? Or you might say, geez, I've been looking for something new to binge watch or some time to watch the shows that I've said I was going to watch for years, so why don't I? So you'll put on The Marvelous Mrs. Maisel. You'll put on Grace and Frankie. You'll put on Supernatural. You'll put on Breaking Bad. Whatever it is that appeals to you. You know, I understand a large percentage of my audience is female. Ladies, Grace and Frankie. But that's a whole other video. Right? And so catch up with friends, you know, make those phone calls that you've been meaning to make, you know, play music. You know, I have Alexa, you know, the Echo from Amazon, and I asked her to play disco today while I cleaned the hell out of my kitchen. If you're going to be stuck in your house, you can use that time productively. Okay. Read a gosh darn book. I've been trying to read Roots by Alex Haley for the last 2 years now, and I keep putting it down because it's so thick that it's daunting. Okay. So, you know, you can use your time constructively to do what you want to do. You know, learn to knit or crochet. If you already know how to knit or crochet, start making stuff. Order some yarn from Amazon and get your button gear, okay? That's handling the situation. Now, all of this that I'm saying to you are just mere suggestions. You know, of course, you take them for what you will and you do what you want. You're going to anyway. But the thing is, I'm saying it because when we do these things, when we do these little things, you know what they are, folks? They're self-care. It's self-care Sundays, okay? I could have made a separate coronavirus video for you. I was gonna make it 2 days ago. You know what I did? I stopped myself because I said, Linda, you need to come up with a self-care Sundays that is going to be meaningful for people in our times. Here we are. Look at the times we're in, okay? We don't know how this is going to end yet. And so isn't it wonderful that if we're given an opportunity to realize how precious our health is, how precious our loved ones are and their health as well, how precious our time is, if our school or our job or whatever have been closed down, how wonderful it is to be given the gift of time. I don't know about you, but as a functioning adult with a job, I feel like my whole day is spent running from fire to fire with only a spray bottle to put them out, and I'm not successful. You know, that's how I spend my time. Isn't it marvelous that if given the opportunity to take it, you know? How to handle the media scrutiny and our anger that people aren't handling things the way they want to. You know, where do you put your anger about what politicians are doing to us in this time of crisis and how they're handling it so gosh darn badly, okay? You know where you can put that anger? By putting it to good use and getting involved, okay? For example, I live in New York City, and they haven't yet closed our public schools. Their rationale is the fact that special needs students, or like the economically disadvantaged students, depend on us for meals and housing during the day. Well, there are contingency plans put in place that would feed those children and house them. So therefore, they're just doing this to punish teachers. I'm sorry, okay? And I can make a whole video about that. This is self-care. I'm talking about how to ease the situation. I'm not gonna get riled up about my situation. Don't worry. What I'm going to say is, as an example, all of us have gotten together and have called 311. You see, here in New York City, we have 311, the phone number you call to lodge a complaint that is city-based, garbage collection, landlord-tenant disputes, school phenomenons, things of that nature, okay? And so we're petitioning the mayor to get us to close schools, right? So you can get involved. Volunteering at your local whatever. Okay, there are crisis centers all over. There are homeless shelters that are teeming with need from people who are afraid of the virus and don't have any place else to go. And they're coming inside and they're depending on that place for a meal. Well, if you're looking for something to do to ease your mental health, one of the best things you could do is to give some mental health or some sustenance to somebody else. Hi, it's Sunday afternoon and I'm sitting here editing this video for you guys. But I forgot to include something rather important and quite touching that I saw last night on Facebook that's a perfect example of what I'm talking about when I say getting involved in your community. Apparently, in Staten Island, New York, which is not far from where I live in Brooklyn, there's a pizzeria called Portofino Pizza. A woman from the place named Alexis writes that if a parent is concerned that their child's school closure will result in them not getting an adequate meal for the day, that child is to come during the school day to Portofino Pizza and be given a bottle of water and a regular slice, no questions asked, no money. That child will also be given a place to sit for a while to concentrate on their schoolwork with adequate heat, electricity, and light. I think that's incredibly generous, wonderful, and a perfect example of communities reaching out to each other in this time of crisis. And now, back to the video. Volunteer at your local shelter. Okay? Like, there is so much we can do that will help us handle this pandemic and will in turn help other people and put our minds at ease. And I have one further suggestion, and that is this. It's real simple. It doesn't cost any money. You don't have to get on the phone. You don't have to volunteer at your shelter or anything. Here's my suggestion. You let the situation run its course and remember that we have been a country for 244 years. You know how I know? Because I was conceived during the bicentennial, okay? And I'm 43. So I know that we've been through tougher shit than this, okay? And if we can go through like the turmoil and horror of 1968 when fearless leaders were gunned down for preaching about peace and unity, if we could get through September 11th, 2001, if we could get through the AIDS crisis, the crack epidemic, the opiate crisis, you know, like, I can't, the, you know, catching Osama bin Laden, you know, I'm just thinking the gas crisis of the 1970s, the rise of cult leaders in the 1970s, the Manson murders, the list goes on and on of things that we've been able to see our way through as a nation, okay? So if we can harness the power that we've had for the past 243 years to fight our belief that we're all gonna die and this is the end of days, okay? Wouldn't it be wonderful just to sit down and do that? You know? And when we get it into our heads that we're all going to live, when we get it into our heads that this is definitely a crisis, don't get me wrong, but it's not the worst crisis we've ever seen, and that it's a very treatable phenomenon, and that buying all the toilet paper in the world may make you happy today, but there's so much more you need to do in here. When you get that through your head, as I have most recently, it took me a little while, but I'm better now, okay? Then that is the ultimate self-care. That's why I saved this for Self-Care Sundays, because folks, let me tell you something. We're gonna make it, okay? And you have two choices. You can make it getting hysterical and not solving anything and only making yourself worse, okay? Or functioning as rationally as you can, taking whatever precautions are necessary, continuing the hand washing and the hand sanitizing and the mask wearing and whatever it is that makes you feel like you have control over this unpredictable virus. That is self-care. Because in the end of the day, you've made yourself feel better in a situation that will get better in time, but is absolutely not better now. And I'm done talking your ear off. I'm Linda, for Linda's World, telling you on this Self-Care Sunday to keep calm as best as you can and know that we've fought other things before. We're gonna fight this. And before I go, I'd just like to let you know that I purposely wore this green sweater for you today because Tuesday is St. Patrick's Day. I'm an Irish person, McManus, and I have to tell you that when I put on my green sweater and I harness my heritage, I truly know that the luck of the Irish is on our side. The Irish have seen many hardships as well, and somehow they always come back with a beer in their hand and a song coming out of their face. And it's awesome. So, we're all gonna live, folks. And we're all going to take care of ourselves and each other. And it's gonna be fine. We got this.